I wanted to make sure we covered at least, there was one topic I want to make sure we covered, and so I asked you to bring it up. So this is your cue, Carol.
Intuition. How do we use intuition?
How do we use it? How do we develop it?
How do we develop it?
Okay. Let me ask you this question. In fact, I'm going to ask each of you, and just give me your response, if you will. Does everybody have the same intuition?
Yes.
No. Well, okay. We have a difference of opinion, well, so let's have a discussion.
The same access to it. Oh. Maybe I misunderstood the question.
Well, it's open to interpretation,
okay.
Isn't it?
All right. Yes, they do. It's a matter of what we put in there to block it. And as I said yesterday, anxiety blocks your intuition. Mm-hmm. And fearing you're going to be wrong blocks your intuition. So the more you can reduce that, the more it just comes right mm-hmm. through you.
Okay.
So
that's you
what
said
I meant
no.
By same.
We don't all have the same intuition.
Well, you said again,
no.
It's a context.
You
I said no.
You said no.
Because there was a context thing, actually, just in terms of your idea of what intuition is versus mine.
Uh-huh.
And we all access from the same place, I think. I believe in that. But
I don't think there's any way to prove that your intuition and mine are identical, mm-hmm. that we have the same access to it or the same level of intuition mm-hmm. that we have the same foundation, let's put it that way. It's just my belief, you know.
We all have the same potential.
The same potential.
I think people's intuition comes through different channels.
Yes.
Like for me, if I make a point of staying as still as I can inside and not be worrying about what I'm going to say next or what the person is saying even, I'm just quiet and taking in. And intuition comes for me in words, not out loud, not like somebody speaking in my head, but an idea will come to me, or maybe just a fragment of an idea. And whatever comes, even if it seems weird, I will just go ahead and go with it, thinking of it as a door and just noticing whether that's going to go somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
But somebody else might have an image that comes to mind, or even a color, or they would have a memory that comes to mind, or they'd get a body feeling. I think we all get our intuitions in different channels.
What would you say to the person who says, I get this all the time, okay, they'll say, well, I mean, I said just these words, but the implication is, well, Gary, you have all this intuition, implying that the person talked to me. I don't, okay? And yet, the belief here is that everybody has the same intuition. So what's the difference?
The blocks to it, beliefs in it, trusting it.
To me, it's trusting it. I think everybody has it.
Yeah.
It's a matter of whether you trust it or not. The intuition is also seems to be garbled up with all your self-talk and your chatter and all that stuff. And so which is which, you know? And so how do you know? How do you know when you're getting genuine guidance or it's just your chatter?
I don't know. I test. I don't know ever. And sometimes it seems weird. And so that's when I'll ask a question that incorporates whatever I'm getting or do something that comes from whatever I'm getting to. And if a door opens, then I go with it. If a door doesn't open, I don't go.
What would be an example? I mean, you ask the client a question? Like something occurs to you and you ask the client something about that.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. I'll get a kind of an internal hit that something is going on inside of them, and it may be totally different from what they're talking about, but I'll just try it out. Ask them a question or something like that. Make a comment. I don't think I test quite as dramatically as you do, but yeah, just see where it goes.
Mm-hmm. I remember the triggers of thought that I had a case a long time ago, and it was a lady, and I was dealing with her. It was over the telephone, and I just the word sister came to me. I didn't know if she had a sister or I had no idea. Okay, but I what I did was just what I picked up what you just said. I actually tested it. Because I said, why do I keep getting the term sister? Why do I keep getting your sister? What is it about your sister? I said, she says, I don't have a sister. All right. Okay. Nonetheless, I have enough leanings, enough trust in this to think there's something to it, even though she doesn't have a sister. Okay. So I just sort of put it on the shelf. We went on about the thing. And it turns out she had a big issue with a nun. Sister somebody, okay, I forgot the name, okay? And there it was. So even when I get information that says to me, oh, that's wrong, but I tested it, I tested the waters, but I got back it was wrong, you know. I'm still puzzled about it. I'm still leaning on it, okay? So But that's what that brings up is there's a if you get a hit like that, you can use the phrase I just used if you want to, something like, why do I keep getting the term Howard, okay, or why do I keep getting the term bridge? Well, you know, how come swimming pool keeps coming up into my mind, okay? And ask them and see what goes on. You know, it's a good way to do that. So how do you develop your, how do you develop trust in your intuition? How do you do that?
Well, trust is action as far as I'm concerned. It's not like I'll trust my intuition when I see results. It's a matter of taking the risks. You know, one thing that I remember, you always talk about stubbing your toe. Uh-huh, don't be afraid to get in there and stub your toe, because maybe your intuition is a little bit off, but what an opportunity. Mm-hmm. Because if my intuition is working, I'm saying, I'll come out with a phrase and I'll ask, is that true for you? And if the person says no, well, what is true for you? Mm-hmm. And the answer just seems to be right there for them.
Sure.
So, kind of.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm. And then it just develops from there. But I don't know, getting myself out of the way, you know, letting EFT work through me rather than by me.
Okay, now that's a great, I brought that whole concept up, you know, and Steph records becoming the ultimate therapist, but how do you just get yourself out of the way? I mean, how do you just do that?
Pray.
Well, I'll tell you something, when I did that workshop, Steph records becoming the ultimate therapist, that was the first time I was going to be on stage, had to get myself out of the way, because that's what I was teaching. Which is interesting, because people have come from all over the world. I've got a note here that says, please turn off your cell phones. Okay. People were coming from all over the world to that workshop. We're on film. You know, do I have my ego in the way? You betcha, you know, because I'm the guy doing the whole thing. I had to get myself out of the way. I didn't have any choice, because as soon as you get yourself in the way, that's when you're more likely to get into trouble. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, if you're going to deal with sophisticated cases, you're going to need to use your intuition, because that's where you're going to start getting the core issue. That's where you're likely to get them, is from these little intuitive hits, you know, and what they mean. But anyway, how do you get yourself out of the way? How do you do it?
For me, it's with curiosity. I think my deepest, most powerful characteristic is curiosity. And I'm in this position as a practitioner of being able to ask people outrageous questions that, you know, nobody would ever have permission to ask somebody. But I'm such a curious person that if they say something that doesn't sound quite right or doesn't make sense to me, I'll ask a question, keep asking until I get an answer. And I think of doing this work, the image I use is inner snowboarding. You know, I've never been snowboarding, but if you're on a snowboard and you're going down a black slope, and you're just in the second, in the moment, you don't have time to think about what you're doing or how you're going to do it, you just go with it and trust that the next millisecond will be okay. And that's what I do. Be quiet inside, be curious, and trust.
And so what if your intuition is wrong? Now what do you do?
Still curious.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Still heading down the slope.
Well, see, there could be this fear in many people who are beginning to trust their intuition, like, boy, if I blurt something like this out and it's wrong, I'm going to look stupid in front of my client.
I tell them that. I tell them, well, I might be really looking stupid here. I might not know what I'm talking about. I get on the same page with them so that they understand that I'm not coming from a position of knowing what I'm doing. I don't know what I'm doing from one moment to the next.
Well, that's a real trust gatherer for the client. I have no idea what I'm doing, but
but I say that in a confident way, and I let them know that it's not about my insecurity. It's not, oh my God, I don't have any trust, but we're in this together. It's our partnership. The healing comes from our partnership, and neither of us really knows what we're doing, but we're having a positive intention that it will work.
Mm-hmm. I like to use this metaphor. I call it the garbage and the gold. And it's a pre-frame that I use often with clients that have never seen me do it or don't know anything about it. I haven't done it up here because most people have seen me do it before. But anyway, I tell them, you know, I'm going to just start saying whatever comes to me. I'm looking for guidance is what I tell them. And I never know if it's going to be true, false, or whatever. So we're going to have a lot of things come out as I do this tapping and we go around, even though I this, da, da, and I go all over the place. But much of it may be garbage, And that's okay, because we're looking for the one little nugget of gold that comes out of there, and that's what really counts here. Now, you pre-frame that right, then you can go, you can make all kinds of mistakes. If you pre-frame it right, you can stub your toe all over the place. Okay, and if you didn't get your piece of gold, next time. Okay, go ahead.
I tell the clients to change my words if they're not right, and I go very, very quickly, and I change the words every spot. And I say, if it's not right, I say, please stop me. And so if I'm a little garbagey and a tiny bit of gold, they'll make the perfect sentence
yes,
and go around
right.
and around. Yeah. But like you, I need to be super quiet and still inside. And again, the more you practice, you know the difference than what is just chatter and static and what is real intuition.
Sure.
And then you test it and throw it out, and it's, how does that sound to you? And they can say no. I think if you've developed enough rapport, they feel safe enough to say no to the clinician that that's not right.
Sure.
Also,
so. And we're back to rapport, which yes. is always important in all of this. Okay. Right.
I think another bit of intuition is actually just paying really good attention.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, noticing that they're about to, tears are just about to come, but they may not even yet be aware of that. And then they're surprised that you know something that they didn't notice, but it's just paying attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a debate sometimes in this whole field about the use of muscle testing. I don't happen to use it very much. I'm not even very good at it. There are people who use it quite proficiently and are very good at it and use it to very, very good results. It's been my view, having done some muscle testing over time, what I eventually came to, as I was doing muscle testing, both surrogate muscle testing, I would test this muscle on behalf of somebody else, or this regular arm muscle testing, is that I knew, eventually, I knew the answer before I even did the muscle test. And so I kind of developed the idea that what muscle testing is training wheels, so to speak, for your intuition. So I don't bother with the training wheels anymore. Guys, got views on that? Do you, any of you muscle test very much?
No.
You don't?
It's all internal. I mean, yeah. I get the test. I get the yes or no, either heart or gut. And it's so loud now that there's...
Oh, you get a physical feeling?
I get a physical feeling.
Describe it, could you?
It's very peaceful and very clean. It's very... It's so obvious. It's hard to describe.
Uh-huh.
It's so obvious. And the yes and no's are so obvious, the difference, and then the no, I can almost get a low, medium, and high. I don't get numbers,
mm-hmm.
but it's kind of like a leaning and go that direction, or I'll notice something, and then I'm focused there.
Yes. Yeah. Good. Okay. Regarding intuition, one of my favorite ways to help somebody trust their intuition is to first have them just guess. If you just guess, when you guess about something with your client, you're just guessing. Is not your intuition somewhere within your guess? If you guess a lot, sooner or later you've got, I mean, your intuition's in there someplace. So you guess at something. And maybe it turns out you're wrong the first time and maybe the second time, but maybe the third, the fourth time, somewhere in there, bingo, okay? And if you look at the odds of that, you know, where that came from, it just came out of the blue and there it was, and by God, it was right on. Now you have a little element of confidence. There's something about my guesses that count here. And now if we can pre-frame this with the garbage and the gold or some other manner by which you don't have to feel stupid when you're wrong, okay, then you can start guessing. You keep guessing, and after a while your guesses count more and more and more, and you start to trust it more and more and more. Okay, that's just a little clue for you. Okay, you guys have any thoughts on that? How would you teach somebody or tell somebody to trust their intuition?
Again, it's action. It's just trying. Mm-hmm. What's the worst that can happen, really, is that they say, no, that's not it.
Sure.
But what's worked best for me is just trying to be empathic with who I'm with. I'm thinking to myself, I wonder what I would feel like if I was in that situation.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can come up with these guesses
mm-hmm.
and just throw them out there and see what happens.
Yeah.
You know, cause I'm thinking, geez, I got this feeling in it. I imagine I would have that same feeling. I wonder if we kind of looked at it this way, what would happen?
Mm-hmm. So we'll
throw that out and boom.
Go ahead.
Something I often do with a client is I start talking about how everything ultimately comes down to yum and yuck. When you think about it, life just comes down to yum and yuck. But most people don't know how to tell, often don't know, which is yum and which is yuck in their bodies. And so I do this little exercise where I ask people to close their eyes and go inside. And I ask a question like, tune into the thought that the world is a friendly place. And just notice how you feel. Notice what comes up. And then open your eyes and then go back inside and tune into the question, the world is an unfriendly place. And notice what happens in your body. And then come back. And then I always ask them to change their positions because, you know, when you change your body position, you change your mind. And I don't want to leave them in the yuck position. And then I ask them, what's the difference in your body sensation? What's the yes in your body and what's the no in your body? And usually, almost everybody can tell. Almost everybody has a yes signal and a no signal. Except there's one caveat there. I run into a number of people who have abuse issues who their only way of saying yes to themselves was to say no to what was happening to them, so they got confused. Yes, they got yes and no confused. And so sometimes you have to make that clear so that they understand what their true yes is and their true no is. And then they have a way of taking any issue and being able to say, this is a yes for me or this is a no.
You do that with a client.
Yeah.
That would be the same thing with any therapist because they could develop their own little, that's their own little muscle test, by the way.
Yeah.
Which is what you're doing. It's your own little muscle test. You just don't call it a muscle test, but it's your signal.
Right. The other thing, Dave and I both work with addictions and for years, and after, that's what's so important about working for so many years with so many clients. After doing thousands and thousands of working with alcoholics or coke addicts, you start, the patterns jump at you. Yes. And people will say, how did you know? Well, in my data bank someplace, because the other 3,400 people who were treated that way by their mother also developed this at this age. And it's hard to explain, but it absolutely jumps out at you.
Sure, yes.
With the practice and the stubbing your toe as many times as possible.
One of the things I think is worthwhile putting out for the intuition part and how it often separates those who do EFT mechanically from those who do it masterfully is those who will do it mechanically will tend to lean on their left brain. That is, they're looking for what's already written on their walls. What can we already do? What is my experience bank here so far? You have a large experience bank outside of intuition, okay? And so do you guys, okay? But if you don't use intuition, you are limited to whatever always there, and that may not be enough. If you're using your right brain, which I'm going to metaphorically say is your intuition in this case, and you're tuning into that, now you have a vast store of possibilities. And compared to what's in your left brain is this big, and the rest of it is as big as this room. You know, so you are. If you're not developing your guesses, your intuition, etc., you are leaving quite a bit on the table, and your ability to handle sophisticated cases is limited as a result of that.